स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतारवरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः। सो गुड मॉर्निंग एंड वेलकम एवरीबॉडी। Today's topic you already know since Swamiji's birthday is coming soon according to the lunar calendar. According to the solar calendar, it falls on the 12th of January, and that is celebrated in India as the National Youth Day. But Belur Math and of course, Belur Math celebrates on 12 January also. Schools and colleges, many boys come, boys and girls, and they have a function throughout the day. But the special puja of Sri Ramakrishna, etc., is held on the birthday according to the lunar calendar. And in our most of our centers also, the celebration is done in the lunar calendar, but in America and other foreign countries, it is generally held on the weekend, either before or after the birthday, according to the lunar calendar, because here people can't come other than on weekends. So Swamiji's birthday is falling on the 4th, I think, this time, 4th February, according to the lunar calendar. So that's why we'll just have a discussion which I've entitled Swami Vivekananda, the Divine Companion of Sri Ramakrishna. So the relation between Sri Ramakrishna and Swami Vivekananda was on an altogether different level, which ordinary people like us can actually never fathom also. It was on such a spiritual level and otherworldly level, we can say, because that relation was formed not in this world, but in a divine world, so to say. And when we read the descriptions of the various meetings between Sri Ramakrishna and Swamiji, the first few meetings, and also the divine vision of Sri Ramakrishna, which he had before Swamiji was born, when we discuss all these, then we will be firmly convinced that Swami Vivekananda's coming, his mission, his relationship with Sri Ramakrishna, all these were divinely ordained. That is why they were so powerful, and still the message of Swamiji, that is why it exerts such a strong influence on the lives of all those who are open to the teachings of the spiritual world. Because open, I'm saying, because those who have shut their minds to it, they will never be influenced by any teaching, even if it is given by God. So the first thing is our willingness to accept, willingness to be rational, willingness to rationally examine our lives, even if such an examination makes bare some unpalatable truths. That is the first condition, you see. Without that frame of mind, without having an open mind, without being accepting, we can never really open ourselves to the teachings of these great saints. That is the thing. So let us start and let us discuss the fascinating story. Of course, we will just deal with one aspect here, and that too not completely, because we are limited by time. So let us see how Swami Vivekananda came, who brought him to this earth, what was his mission to some extent, and a glimpse into the divine relation which existed between these two divine souls, Sri Ramakrishna and Vivekananda. So, it has been beautifully described by a monk of our order that Sri Ramakrishna and Vivekananda, how they were related. So he begins by saying, we all know that Sri Ramakrishna had performed various kinds of sadhanas. He had not only within the domain of Hindu religion, we can say that he was the first incarnation to practice the spiritual disciplines of many other important religions like Islam, Christianity, etc. So the question has been raised that if Sri Ramakrishna was God incarnate, then what is the meaning of his performance of spiritual practices? Why does God himself need to perform sadhana? Generally, what do we say? That sadhana is for the purification of our minds, purification of our souls. So if Sri Ramakrishna was God himself, he did not need to purify himself. He was purity incarnate. So then why did he perform sadhana at all? So the answer, there are many answers. It has been discussed in many books, and of course, it has been discussed in Swami Sardaranji's great biography of Sri Ramakrishna, the most authentic one. So one of the beautiful answers which I found, that why did Sri Ramakrishna perform sadhana or spiritual disciplines? The answer given is divine self-giving. Divine self-giving of Sri Ramakrishna. Through his sadhana, Sri Ramakrishna gave himself up to humanity. This is a beautiful interpretation. So, how did this happen? So, it has been described beautifully. Through Sri Ramakrishna's sadhana, the goal himself became the ways. The goal himself became the ways. Now see how beautifully it has been put. The goal of all humanity is God, Sri Ramakrishna. So through his sadhana, the goal himself became the ways. Ways means the spiritual paths through which we approach God. So Sri Ramakrishna, the goal, himself transformed himself into the ways also. The ways means the various paths through which we can reach God. He became, so to say, non-different from his spiritual practices or sadhana. So that Adopting these paths, adopting various types of sadhanas, an ordinary human being can also hope to approach him, which is the goal. Suppose Sri Ramakrishna had not performed any sadhana at all. Suppose he had come as a divine being, all-knowing, omniscient, never making any kind of mistake, and gone away like that only. If it had happened like that, ordinary people like us, how could they ever benefit by his coming on earth? Just imagine. We could not have benefited because he would have belonged to another realm altogether, another world. Ordinary people, how could he connect with him? The very purpose of his coming would be, there would be no purpose in his coming. It wouldn't have been fulfilled. But he came, he adopted all the imperfections of ordinary human beings like us, not all of course, some, and he, by showing his own life, by demonstrating in his own life, he showed us how we can approach him and finally reach him. So this was done through his sadhana. So actually, through his sadhana, he gave himself up and showed us the path to reach him. So that is why it is said that the goal himself became the ways and reached down to you and me, so that by treading on those ways, we can reach the goal. This is the thing. So if God did not show us the way to reach him, left to ourselves, an ordinary person could never hope to find him. So his sadhana was for all humanity, and it was a way of his giving himself away to all of us. So it is for this self-giving that Sri Ramakrishna came, and in this self-giving of God to man, in this incarnation of God, Vivekananda, who was Narendranath Datta previously, he became Sri Ramakrishna's chief instrument. This is the thing. Because you see, even when the omniscient and omnipotent God assumes a body, he is limited by the body. Now, when God incarnated at Sri Ramakrishna, he was limited by his body. He couldn't be at two places at the same time. He couldn't teach two generations at the same time. That's why even God needs help to fulfill his divine mission. And for this help, he needs perfected souls. Because you see, to gain perfection needs a lot of time. If he would have chosen an ordinary person to be his chief instrument, by the time that ordinary person had realized the goal and achieved the status of Vivekananda, maybe 500 years would have gone by. So he did not have so much time. He had to bring himself a finished product, absolutely ready to teach, who had nothing to gain for himself, who had achieved everything. So these he brought not one or two but many, because there are many souls whom he characterized as ever free, apart from Swamiji also, like Swami Brahmananda, Swami Premananda, etc. They were already free. They had nothing to gain. They did not perform sadhana for their own sake. So they were ready to spread the message of the master from their very birth. So that is why a soul like Vivekananda was needed to spread द मास्टर्स मैसेज एंड टू बी हिज चीफ इंस्ट्रूमेंट. दिस इज द थिंग. एंड एज वी ऑल नो, श्री रामकृष्ण न्यू, सिंस ही वॉज गॉड हिमसेल्फ, ही न्यू द पर्पस ऑफ हिज प्रेजेंट इंकार्नेशन, एंड ही ऑल्सो न्यू दैट सम ग्रेट सोल्स वर बॉर्न टू हेल्प हिम फुलफिल हिज डिवाइन लीला और डिवाइन प्ले, एंड ही न्यू हुम amongst all those sent by the will of God would be playing greater and lesser roles in this divine leela. And the greatest role, apart from of course Holy Mother, because Holy Mother was not at all different from Sri Ramakrishna, apart from Holy Mother, the greatest role was played by Swami Vivekananda. This is the thing. So established in the divine state called Bhavamukha. Bhavamukha has been discussed beautifully, the significance of Bhavamukha. That is a separate subject which we can discuss later, but we can know this for now, that Bhavamukha was a divine state, and established in that state, the master knew when his chosen devotees would arrive. So let us go directly to the first meeting between Sri Ramakrishna and his chief instrument, who was to fulfill his divine mission on earth, Swami Vivekananda. The first meeting was held at the house of Surendranath Mitra of Shimla, Calcutta. He was a devotee of Sri Ramakrishna. And, you know, devotees would often invite the master to their homes for celebrations, etc. So once Surendranath Mitra had invited Sri Ramakrishna to his own home for such a festival. And fortunately, he could not find a singer to sing devotional songs on that day. I say fortunately because since he could not find a singer, he called Narendranath Datta of Shimla to sing songs for the master on that day. As you know, Narendranath was none other than the future Swami Vivekananda. So Swamiji came and sang songs for the master, and this was the first meeting between him and Sri Ramakrishna. It was the year 1881 and the month of November, and Narendra was only 18 years old and studying at the Calcutta University. So at this very first meeting, Sri Ramakrishna, it is said, he was greatly attracted to this young boy who sang so beautifully. So he immediately recognized him, we all know, and from Sri Ramakrishna's vision, which we shall discuss next, we will know that the master immediately recognized Narendranath Datta for who he was, and therefore was greatly attracted to him. So in the very first meeting, he examined Narendranath's features, facial features, and he also told Surendranath Mitra and some other devotees that they should bring Narendranath with them to Dakshineshwar, or tell Narendranath to come and meet him at Dakshineshwar. Now the question is, how did the master recognize Sri Narendranath Datta's real nature at the very first meeting, and why did he feel so greatly attracted to him? For the answers to these questions, we have to discuss the wonderful vision which Sri Ramakrishna had the wonderful and revealing vision which he had regarding Swami Vivekananda much before he actually met him. So fortunately, we have a very detailed description of this vision from none other than Sri Ramakrishna himself. Because you see, these saints and sages, so rarely they describe their divine visions. But fortunately, Sri Ramakrishna has described this in great detail. Of course, people like us will not be able to understand much, but even hearing this gives us an idea of the divine realm from which Swami Vivekananda had come. So I will not summarize the vision or condense it in any way. I will read the whole thing which Sri Ramakrishna had said and which has been recorded in Saradaranji's biography of the master. So I quote Sri Ramakrishna himself. He said, "One day I found that my mind was soaring high in samadhi along a luminous path. It soon transcended the stellar universe and entered the subtle realm of ideas. As it ascended higher and higher, I found the path lined with forms of gods and goddesses on both sides. My mind then reached the outer limits of that region where a luminous barrier separates the sphere of relative existence from that of the absolute. My mind crossed that barrier to enter the transcendental realm where no corporeal being was visible. Even the gods dare not enter that sublime realm and were content to keep their seats far below. But the next moment, I saw seven venerable rishis seated there in samadhi. It occurred to me that these rishis must have surpassed not only humans, but even the gods in knowledge and holiness, in renunciation and love. Lost in admiration, I was reflecting on their greatness when I saw a portion of that undifferentiated luminous region condense into the form of a divine child. This child came to one of the rishis, tenderly clasped his neck with his lovely arms, and addressing him in a sweet voice, tried to drag his mind down from the state of samadhi. That magic touch roused the rishi from the superconscious state, and he fixed his half-opened eyes upon the wonderful child. His beaming countenance showed that the child was the treasure of his heart. In great joy, the divine child spoke to him, 'I am going down. You must go with me.' The rishi remained mute, but his tender look expressed his assent. As he gazed at the child, he again became immersed in samadhi. I was surprised to see a fragment of his body and mind then descending to earth in the form of a bright light. No sooner had I seen Narendra than I recognized him to be that rishi." This is the wonderful description which Sri Ramakrishna gives So the thing is, you see, his mind soared so high that it even transcended the realm of the gods. And he says that he transcended even this relative existence. This whole world of Maya, it transcended. And it entered the transcendental realm, which was so high that even gods dare not approach that realm. And there he saw those rishis, which according to his description were the highest of the high. Because you see, as soon as we accept dualism, as soon as we are in the domain of Maya, we have to admit that there is a relative existence and there is a transcendental existence also. So Sri Ramakrishna's mind had gone completely beyond Maya, so to say, because nowhere in this relative existence could he find someone who would be fit to bear his message and transmit it to humanity. So these beings, those rishis, we can assume that they were just below the Supreme Lord himself, maybe one stage below Almighty God himself. And for the sake of humanity, he brought one such rishi to earth for our sake. Another point worth noting is that this child, when he clasped the neck of the rishi and said to him in a tenderly loving voice, the sage was roused from his samadhi. So, what brought this rishi down? Through what power was the sage awakened from samadhi? It was through the power of love. When that small divine child entreated that sage tenderly, that power of love, even brought that sage down from the level of samadhi. This is the power of love. No other force, most probably, could have awakened that sage and brought his mind down. So this is worth noting, that when we approach great people, when we approach saints, we should know, and of course when we approach God himself, we should know that only true love can evoke a response from these saints and God. That is why in one of her famous songs, Mirabai says, Bina prem ke nahi mile Nandalala. Nandalala means the son of Nanda, that is Sri Krishna, that means God himself. Without love, without the divine love, we cannot expect a response from God. This is another great message which we learn from this divine vision of Sri Ramakrishna. So, in response to God's earnest appeal, through the power of that love, the love of God for humanity, the rishi was awakened from samadhi and he descended from that supernatural region to earth for ordinary people like us. Beyond this You see, it is extremely difficult to understand the great significance of this vision of the Master, because we are tied down to this earthly realm. We don't know anything higher. So, how, in what way the Master actually transcended all these realms and made Narendranath, that Rishi, come in the form of Narendranath, what a great thing it was, maybe we still don't have the capacity to appreciate it. Now we will go to the second meeting of the Master and Narendranath. This second meeting occurred in Dakshineshwar. Fortunately, we have the description of this meeting from none other than Sri Ramakrishna himself. Okay, so let us see what the Master said when Narendranath Datta, a young boy of 18 years old, entered his room in Dakshineshwar for the first time. Sri Ramakrishna said, quote, Narendra entered the room by the western door, the one that faces the Ganges. So those who have seen Sri Ramakrishna's room at Dakshineshwar must have noticed that there are three doors. The one opens towards the Nahabat, the left door opens towards the Ganges, and the third door behind him opens towards Mother Kali's temple, towards the courtyard. So Sri Ramakrishna's bed is facing the opposite, is facing the door to the Nahabat. Means Sri Ramakrishna's back was towards the door which opens on the courtyard. So Narendra entered from the left side. The left side, the door was facing the Ganges, towards the Ganges. So Narendra entered from there. Okay, after this Sri Ramakrishna says, quote, I noticed that he was not concerned about his appearance. His hair and clothes weren't tidy at all. Unlike his companions, he seemed completely detached, as if nothing external appealed to him. His eyes showed that the greater part of his mind was turned inward all the time. When I saw this, I marveled to myself, how is it possible that such a great spiritual aspirant can live in Calcutta, home to such materialistic people? There was a mat spread out on the floor. I asked him to be seated, and he sat down near the jar of Ganga water. A few of his friends were with him that day. I asked him about his singing and found that he knew only two or three songs in Bengali. I asked him to sing them. He began singing this Brahmo song, Let us return once more, O mind, to our own abode. This song is there in the gospel. Mono cholo nijo niketone. Niketone means own abode. O my mind, let us go back to our own abode. Here in this foreign land of earth, why should we wander aimlessly in strangers' guise? These living beings round about and the five elements are strangers to you, all of them. None is your own. Why do you thus forget yourself in love with strangers, O my mind? Why do you thus forget your own? So this was the song which Narendra sang on that day. And Sri Ramakrishna said, he sang that song with his whole soul as though he were deep in meditation. When I heard it, I couldn't control myself. I went into ecstasy. This is the beautiful description which Sri Ramakrishna gives of his first meeting with Swamiji at Dakshineshwar. So from this meeting, from what the master said, we can learn many things. Many kinds of messages are hidden in these words of the master. What they may be, let us try to analyze with whatever intelligence, little intelligence God has given us. See, Sri Ramakrishna says, here, you mind you, when Sri Ramakrishna describes the appearance and the look of Narendranath, he is describing the look and appearance of a very, very high saint. Now, in our scriptures, we will see when we study the Gita and other scriptures, at various points, the characteristics of saints have been described in a beautiful way. Now the question has been raised, why those characteristics have been described? So in answer, Sri Shankaracharya has said in his commentary on the Gita, they have been described because so that we recognize those signs and try to emulate them in our own lives. So here when Sri Ramakrishna describes the characteristics of Narendranath, we should remember that these are the characteristics of a saint par excellence, and that we should also note them and compare them with our own nature and try to emulate them. This is the thing. So what does Sri Ramakrishna says? Unlike his companions, he seemed completely detached. Mind you, this is one characteristic. He seemed completely detached from the world. His mind was always, it seemed that looking at him, his mind was always on a different realm. So this is the first thing, complete detachment. He says then, as if nothing external appealed to him. See, these are very important words. Nothing external will appeal to a saint. A saint knows that what is internal is far, far more superior to the whole external universe. Having realized that, he will find nothing which attracts him in this world. So when we find something attractive in this universe, attractive in this world, we should examine our own minds. That why are we getting attracted to this and that thing? We are getting attracted because we find them worthwhile. But saints have seen that there is nothing worthwhile in this world at all. So if our vision differs from their vision, something is wrong with our vision. Okay. Then Sri Ramakrishna says, his eyes showed that the greater part of his mind was turned inward all the time. See these characteristics and just see how far we are from from this state. Of course, we can never hope to attain the state of Swami Vivekananda, but even if being a devotee is our aim in life, how far we are from this state. Our eyes should also be turned inwards all the time. While we are so much attracted to outer things that rarely, maybe twice a day, we somehow try to shut our minds and see inward, then maybe after half an hour we get up and say, ah, enough of meditation. Okay. So these things have to be thought about, you see. If we are serious about our lives, these things have to be thought about. How much external world has lost its importance for us? How much has been our vision turned inwards? Then Sri Ramakrishna says, when I saw him, I marveled to myself, how is it possible that such a great spiritual aspirant can live in Calcutta, home to such materialistic people? Now, this is a very important statement. All of us have read this. But have we tried to find the meaning of this? Sri Ramakrishna says that it is very difficult for a saint to live in the midst of worldly people. Because he finds it surprising that from Calcutta, where there are so many materialistic people living, from there, how can such a saint come? If a saint comes from an assembly of saints, that is not surprising, because he is coming from like-minded people, from the company of great people. But Sri Ramakrishna is surprised that from the company of worldly people, how is this saint coming? So what does this show? This shows that worldly company, the company of people who are attached to this world, is not conducive for a devotee. A devotee, if he lives in that company, he will find it extremely difficult to progress towards God. So from this one line of Sri Ramakrishna, the message is, avoid worldly company if one aspires to be a devotee. Because living in those company of those people, the minds of even great people can come down to a lower level. So this was what Sri Ramakrishna said about the first visit of Swami Vivekananda, the future Swami Vivekananda, to Dakshineshwar. And many more things happened, which you will see, which Sri Ramakrishna did not reveal on that day. Because maybe he felt hesitant to show how he felt on meeting his dear Narendranath, whom he had brought from such a high realm. Fortunately for us, Swami Vivekananda described what happened afterwards. So, since we have Swami Vivekananda's account, we can now see how Sri Ramakrishna treated him, treated Narendranath Datta, with what great reverence Sri Ramakrishna treated his divine companion. So after that, what happened? Narendra sang that song, and he said, I quote Swami Vivekananda, as soon as I finished the song, the master stood up, took me by the hand, and led me out to the northern veranda. It was winter, So the open spaces between the pillars were covered with screens of matting to keep out the north wind. This meant that anyone standing on the veranda was completely hidden when the door of the room was closed. So the master closed the door as soon as we were on the veranda. I thought he was going to give me some private instructions, but what he said and did next was something I could never have believed possible. He suddenly caught hold of my hand and began shedding profuse tears of joy. He said to me affectionately, as to an intimate friend, "You have come so late. Was that right? Didn't you guess how I have been waiting for you? My ears have nearly burned off from listening to the talk of these worldly people. I thought I would burst without anyone to tell how I really feel." He went on like that, raving and weeping. Then he suddenly stood up with his palms folded together and began addressing me as if I were some divine being. "I know who you are, my lord. You are Nara, the ancient sage, the incarnation of Narayana. You have come to earth to take away the suffering and sorrow of human beings." I was absolutely dumbfounded by this conduct. I said to myself, "What kind of a man is this? He must be raving mad. He must be mad. I am the son of a Vishwana Datta, a lawyer, and he is telling that I am some sort of divine being who's come to him and that he had been waiting for me. This is a crazy person whom I have come to see." This is what Swami Vivekananda felt after what Sri Ramakrishna said to him. So some of what the master said are worth thinking about. So he says, "Didn't you guess how I've been waiting for you? My ears have nearly burnt off from listening to the talk of these worldly people. I thought I would burst without anyone to tell how I really feel." So the worldly talk which we indulge in day and night, night after night and day after day, see what reaction will a saint have to that. He says, Sri Ramakrishna says, "My ears are nearly burnt." He is suffering so much hearing those worldly talks. So if we find ourselves discussing worldly things all the time, we should know that if Sri Ramakrishna comes to us, he will not stay long because his ears will be burnt off by our talk. And the second thing Sri Ramakrishna says is, how I was eagerly waiting for someone whom I could tell how I really feel, with whom Sri Ramakrishna could share his experiences. With whom Sri Ramakrishna, see, how can he share his experiences with an ordinary person? Suppose someone has great qualification, someone or like all of you is a PhD or MSc, something like that. Now, if for a discussion, a boy who's studying in nursery is brought, then how will that person communicate with that boy? How can such a great person of such great qualifications make that boy understand what he has achieved. He can never do that. So Sri Ramakrishna similarly found that only very great souls, very pure souls would be able to understand his achievements and his experiences. He could unburden his heart only to them. So if we want to approach God, we should bear these statements of Sri Ramakrishna in mind. If our minds are full of worldly thought, God will never be able to approach it. His ears will be burnt off. And how can there be a communication between God and ourselves till our mind is pure enough to understand what spiritual experiences are all about? Till we approach that state, God can never enter our hearts at all. This is what Sri Ramakrishna, maybe he wants to convey by these few sentences he said to Swami Vivekananda. We can read these and then we should try to understand what these imply in our lives. God, how can God, at what stage will God be able to approach us? What state should our mind be? That is why Sri Ramakrishna gives the example of that temple. One boy was there. He was to look after a temple. The temple was completely dirty. And the boy used to go out and blow on his conch. So in the gospel it is there, we can read it fully afterward. So Sri Ramakrishna said, "You fool, the whole temple is dirty. How will God come in that dirty temple and you are blowing off your conch like that? First purify that temple. What is that temple? That temple is our heart." So we may say that, we may wonder why Sri Ramakrishna showered so much love on these people. But why isn't he showering his grace upon us? So we should ask ourselves, have we made ourselves ready to receive his grace? Have we made our hearts pure enough? Or are we even trying? Are we even trying 1%? Let us ask ourselves. So these are very significant, beautiful descriptions of the Master and Swamiji. I thought I would finish today, but we have already reached the limit. So we can continue this future meetings of Swami Vivekananda and Ramakrishna, very beautiful and fascinating. And a few words also on how Sri Ramakrishna dealt with Swamiji in the first few meetings, how he trained him to make him a perfect instrument for spreading his divine message. So we can end here, and before ending, of course, I will like to show you a beautiful video. Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Tat Sat Shri Ram Krishna Arpanamastu. So fortunately, one of my acquaintances sent me a wonderful video of very young children singing a song on Swami Vivekananda beautifully, and they were dressed up like Swamiji with a turban and all. The song is in Hindi, but even those who understand Bengali will be able to follow it. So it was so beautiful that I thought of sharing with you. So we will just 1 minute, let me open it and share. Okay, I've opened that. Now let me share. So I hope you can see this.
Mama, mama, sorry, mama, sorry.
So I hope to enjoy such a beautiful video. One feels like seeing it again and again. Okay, so this much for today, and we will continue this